Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Reclaiming Church, a call to action for religious rejects by J.J. Warren, and narrated by J.J. Warren. Thanks for joining me for this reading. Foreword by Bishop Karen P. Olivito. You have to give them hope. Harvey Milk. As a young person, I always knew there was something different about me, although I didn't have a name for it. As friends began dating, I found myself feeling increasingly unlike them. I had no interest at all in having a boyfriend. I didn't want to go to the homecoming or the prom. What was wrong with me? I felt increasingly alienated from so many of my peers. Their lives seemed foreign to me. As much as I tried to join in activities that centered on creating romantic ties with the opposite sex, it always felt like something wasn't right. The one place that made me feel like I had a home was my local church. Our youth group was a sanctuary for so many of us. We were invited to be our authentic selves, even when we weren't sure what that meant, and encouraged to become leaders. We came from several different high schools. For the most part, we didn't quite fit in. Years later, at a beach where we had shared so many memories, we gathered for a youth group reunion. One of my friends said, "Thank God for our youth group. It was the one place we misfits found a place to belong." It would not be until my first year of seminary that I realized there was a name for what I was feeling and for who I was. At seminary, I listened to the stories of my gay and lesbian classmates and realized their stories sounded a lot like mine. When I was finally able to say to myself, "I am a lesbian," all of the confusing pieces of my life came together, and I experienced a profound sense of wholeness and peace. Looking back, I wish I could talk to my younger self, look her in the eyes and tell her, "You're going to be okay. You are going to figure out what is different about you, and it will be a great gift. It will deepen your empathy with those who are different. It will give you a powerful community, and you will find deep and abiding love." What a difference that hopeful conversation would have made in my journey. If you are wondering if there is a place for you, if you wonder if you will ever find community, if you are feeling like a reject because of what others say about you or what you might think about yourself, this book is for you. It will give you hope when hope feels lost. And it has its origins in a most hopeless event. The General Conference of the United Methodist Church, held every 4 years, is the best and worst of times. United Methodist delegates, bishops, general church staff, and observers gather from around the world to determine who we will be for the next 4 years, revising our ways to meet the changing needs of the church, to respond in ministry to a changing world. This gathering is accompanied by spirited worship, moving sermons, and powerful testimony of the ways United Methodists are sharing the love of God with neighbors around the world. It is also a time of political maneuvering, jockeying for power, and raucous debates that, at times, debase the diversity reflected in God's beloved children. It was the latter description that filled the convention center in St. Louis on February 23rd to the 26th, 2019, for the special session of the General Conference. The church had reached a breaking point regarding an understanding of the role of queer United Methodists in the life and ministry of the denomination. In response to the tension, a commission on a way forward was convened with the purpose of proposing a way to strengthen church unity and mission while acknowledging the different opinions regarding homosexuality held by faithful United Methodists. The commission worked for more than 2 years perfecting the One Church Plan, which removed anti-queer language from the Book of Discipline, BOD, while acknowledging that different contexts and personal conscience would reflect different responses to the role of queer people in the church. This plan was accepted by a large majority of the Council of Bishops. The delegates, however, rejected the plan and opted instead to focus their work on the traditional plan, which not only continued the anti-queer language of the BOD, but doubled down on enforcement and punishment. By February 25th, it was clear where the votes were heading, and despair hung over the dais where I sat with my fellow bishops. One bishop was so agitated that he couldn't sit in his chair but kept pacing back and forth behind us, muttering, "They are destroying our church." Some bishops were in tears. Others put their heads down in prayer. A thick pall had fallen over the convention center. And then, a young person from Upper New York was called to the microphone. Within 3 minutes, J.J. Warren had dispelled the gloom. It felt like Pentecost, as the Holy Spirit breathed life into the somber hall, and people were brought to their feet with shouts of amen and applause. J.J. had helped us remember what we were all forgetting, that the purpose of the church is to offer Jesus, and J.J. has continued to help us remember. General Conference delegates did indeed vote to adopt the traditional plan, one that had, at multiple times, been deemed unconstitutional by the Judicial Council, the Supreme Court of the denomination, and tightened restrictions against Queer United Methodists and those who would offer them the full ministry of the church. The vote perhaps dealt a mortal blow to the denomination itself, and once again wounded its queer members and our loved ones. The news of the delegates' vote reverberated around the world as news outlets reported the impact of the vote on local communities. Clergy wondered how they could continue to serve in such a church. Lay members were embarrassed by the General Conference actions taken. One woman in my conference told me how she turned her United Methodist canvas bags inside out when she shopped so no one would see what she was carrying. She was, for the first time in her life, embarrassed to be a United Methodist, and queer people were once again left bloodied by a vote about them. JJ's speech and the hope he inspired at General Conference sent him on a cross-country trek, a one-man evangelistic mission to remind the church to give folks Jesus. All folks, not some of the folks, and especially to queer people. JJ has offered with his book and his mission the gift of hope. Hope that Scripture really is liberating. Hope that God's love is for all, with no exceptions. Hope in Jesus, who breaks open new life for everyone. Hope in the Holy Spirit, who is forever expanding the circle of who is included. And hope in a community made richer by diversity. May the hope found in this book be a healing balm for those wounded by the actions of General Conference. May it offer a hope in the face of bullying and belittling. May it be a wake-up call to those who have grown complacent to the injustices of the status quo. May it be a journey to radical discipleship for those ready to take on the invitation and challenge offered by Jesus. And, in the end, may you, too, give others hope. Bishop Karen P. Olivito, Denver, Colorado, September 26, 2019. Introduction. This book is for the queer kids. It's for people who wrestle with whether or not they can stay in the churches that raise them. It's for those who mourn the church's failure to engage with social justice, who have been told by a church that their identity is wrong or incompatible with Christian teaching. It's also for those leaders who have worked for decades to make their churches safe spaces for the LGBTQ+ community. This book is for all of us who hear the word church and instantly think of debate, exclusion, injustice, and fear. Maybe you've written off church completely, but you know deep within your bones that these injustices cannot be what God intended the church to be. If that uncomfortable gnawing on your spirit has brought you here, if that voice in your head keeps saying, something's got to change, then maybe you have an inner conviction to see the church become more than it is. Maybe, just maybe, we've been called to reclaim the very idea of what church is and who is allowed in together. Even though many of us queer kids have called churches our homes, some denominations don't allow us to be who we are, to be ordained as pastors, or our marriages to be celebrated in church buildings simply because of whom we love or how we identify. Some people in my church claim to welcome me, but will not recognize the deep commitment and love I have for my partner, and the love I have for God. Some people will welcome me into their pews, but not behind their pulpits. This is not a welcome, but rather an invitation to second-class citizenship. Some say they love us because they love the sinner, hate the sin. For us queer kids, that's impossible, because what they believe is our sin is inseparable from who we are. We are who God has created us to be, beautifully queer children. And there is no sin in that. The institutional church, that's the capital C, has used God's name to exclude groups of people throughout history and has instigated the deaths and suicides of so many. And so, you might ask me why I persist. Why do I stay in an institution that continually harms me and many other groups of people, especially queer people, people of color, and women in ministry? Maybe you feel this same tension and you're ready to leave. For me, it all started at a microphone with a 3-minute speech at a global gathering of the United Methodist Church. Since I'm not under a timer anymore, this book is my response. These words are my vision and hope for the future, an invitation to action for each of us. We can join together and begin reclaiming what church is from the harmful hands of fundamentalism. We, the religious rejects, can be the church, and we have the opportunity to reclaim what it means to be a Christian today. Together, we can reclaim church as a place of justice-seeking, loving, and passionate people who are actively creating heaven on earth for all. The speech. I walked to the microphone, and I could feel my body shivering with nerves. My chest was tight, and it was getting hard to breathe. Thousands of eyes suddenly looked at me, and I wasn't sure what to say. I wish I could have shared my story, my journey as a gay Christian who feels called to ministry in a more private setting, but I didn't get that chance. For some reason, that was the moment, and my life has been forever changed because of it. It was February 25th. 2019, and voting delegates from United Methodist churches around the world had gathered in St. Louis. We sat in a football stadium, and despite the tables and chairs, the mood in the arena still felt like a competition. Tables and chairs had been added to the field so that it would feel less like a brutal competition. It didn't. Our task was to decide whether or not our church around the world would allow queer people to be ordained as pastors and married in our churches. This was a special conference. Usually, we meet every 4 years and discuss topics like education or our efforts in combating malaria. But this time, we met for the sole purpose of deciding whether or not our church would include people like me. It's a painful thing to have people around the world discuss whether or not you should exist, or at least whether or not you can serve God, but that was the purpose there. I was still a senior in college, and I was a reserve delegate from the Upper New York area. That's an area of about 800 churches in upstate New York, all of New York, excluding New York City. Being a reserve delegate meant that I didn't go on the floor of the conference, where the voting members sat, unless another delegate from my conference needed a break. "Put me in, coach," is what I wanted to say, as I sat in the stadium seating high up above, as more than 800 people from all parts of the world decided my fate. I had to sit and watch from the balcony. Maybe you did watch the conference, or you've experienced moments like this, where the people around you talk about part of who you are without ever talking about you as a human being, or with you as an equal. It's tough, but it's helpful to know that we're not alone in this feeling. It was the evening of the 25th, the second to last day of the conference, and it wasn't going well. Those who wanted to keep us queer people out of the pulpits and wedding chapels were getting their way. People were saying horrible things about homosexuals and aggressively arguing with one another in an international spotlight. The Bible was being used to justify the exclusion of LGBTQ+ folks, and Christians weren't acting very Christ-like. It was ugly and heavy, and it was the top lawmaking body of my church. It was on this evening, as it seemed like our church was ending, and only a couple of queer people got a chance to talk, that one of the delegates from my area sent me a text. "If the plans about LGBTQ+ inclusion come up again, you can take my seat." He continued, "Our church is falling apart anyways, so it won't make a difference whether you're up there or down here." It didn't sound very hopeful, and it seemed too late for the plans to come up again anyway. But I sent back, "Okay, thanks." The plans about inclusion did come up just as the day was ending, and I got the text, "Hurry. Come, take my seat." My heart started to thump in my throat, and I quickly looked around. I was sitting next to a sweet older woman from my area who had been cracking jokes all weekend to keep my spirits up. "Shirley, will you watch my bags? I'm going on the floor." She smiled with her big grandmother smile and said, "Sure, honey, get down there." I sprinted down 2 escalators, checked in at 2 security checkpoints, and ran to the table where they gave me a voting device. I was out of breath and frantically checking my phone to see where the other guy was. "I'm here. Where are you?" I texted and impatiently peeked through the doorway into the conference. Just then, he walked in, and the folks at the table deactivated his card and activated mine. I tried to play it cool as I emerged from the doorway and onto the vast arena floor. The lights were bright, and it felt like everyone was looking at me, even though they weren't. I quickly walked to the table where delegates from my area were sitting. "Hey, we're glad you're here," one of them whispered. I sat down. took a breath, and pushed the little gray button on my voting device to speak. I had no idea at all what I would say, but I knew I had to say something. There were people who had their speak button pressed for days, but were never called on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.